Thanks, Juliet. And I'm thanking all the organizers for simply making this happen. I enjoyed it up till now very much. Okay. Sorry? Oh, yes. Yes, maybe I would, because I like to walk, yeah. Is it this? Oh, no, but I have no... No, I don't mind. Is this okay?
Open it on
first. Oh, yes, sorry.
There you go.
Yes?
Just a moment.
Yes. Is it okay? Yeah? Good. So I'm going to talk about proofs, simple proofs, but also about complex proofs. And in fact, what I'm going to talk about is about formal proofs. So in here, you could put the word formal. Now, the thing is, when you formalize things, it's always like this, that you gain something and you lose something. And what you gain here is that you can see that you can, so to say, by being very precise about what a proof is, you can, and also about what simplicity is, you can really prove some things about it. And you can see, for example, that some forms of simplicity contradict each other and things like that. Of course, what you lose is that you have this rich subject, simplicity, everybody feels a lot when you say the word simplicity, and you don't capture all of that when you formalize it. But you can capture parts of it, and I think it can teach you something about also this rich, varied notion, simplicity. What we, for example, also will see is that despite the fact that I'm going to talk about simple proofs, that some of the things related to simple proofs are extremely complex and are in fact related to one of the most famous and long-standing open problems in science, in computer science and in mathematics. I will all tell you about this. Okay. I start with a quote by Albert Einstein. I was afraid that somebody before me would already have quoted this, but luckily this wasn't the case. So Albert Einstein at some point in his life said, "I have deep faith that the principle of the universe will be beautiful and simple." And note what I find very remarkable is that he says principle and not the principle. So this is really a very grand statement. And the thing is, if you translate this to mathematics, I think it would become something like this. A mathematician, but I put it now as a question because I'm not sure I agree, would say, do I have deep faith that true statements have beautiful and simple proofs? Well, already yesterday we had at the panel, we had a long discussion about this, and I will take this up again at the panel discussion on Friday because I think this is, of course, a very interesting question. But I'm not going to answer it today, although, as we will see, if you make these notions precise, as I'm going to do now during this talk, I mean, precise and also making them more meager in some sense, then it's very difficult to answer this question, as we need. Okay. Now, the thing is, with proofs, there are various ways to measure the simplicity of a proof, and we saw this already in many talks, in fact, in the last question as well about the Shepherd stroke. It is, in fact, what do you consider simple? Is it the fact that you only have one connective? Of course, I think you have good grounds to say, well, then you have a very simple representation of all your statements. But on the other hand, you could say, well, when I only have this one connective, my proofs may get very long. So in some sense, it's not simple. So you have various notions of simplicity. And then the thing is that if you want to be a bit more precise about what a proof or an argument is, you have to be precise about what you assume and what you allow as inference as the rules of reasoning. So you have to be precise, so to say, about the rules of the game. Yeah? And you play by the rules of the game. So what I mean here with the second statement is that in thinking about formal proofs, in fact, what you do, you think about what is called a proof system. And a proof system is nothing but being very precise about what you're talking about, so to say, is it about geometry, is it about finite groups or mechanics or whatever, And the other thing you're very precise about is the rules, as I said before, that you're allowed to use, yeah? So geometry is probably still the best known example, Euclid's geometry, in which he has certain axioms. He says, well, this is obviously true about geometry, and this is also obviously true, like through every 2 points, there is a unique line, etc. And then you have rules, and he's not explicit about that, in fact, but nowadays we are. This is all going back to Hilbert, in fact, is being precise also about the rules. He's very precise about, if I have proven this, and I've proven that, then I may also conclude this. Yeah, the rules that bring you from one truth, one theorem, to another. Yeah? And this, so to say, this is what a proof system is. Now, the thing is, then if you consider this, your proofs and your proof system, there are various ways in which simplicity can play a role. Namely, the first thing is what I mentioned in my abstract also, is that simplicity can be used as a guide in designing proof system. And what I mean is that when you want to think about a certain subject, again, as geometry or finite groups or something else, then you have to decide what you consider to be the basic truth. And this is not always that obvious, what choice you have to make. In many cases, there are various choices, and it's difficult to say, well, this is the right choice and this is not the right choice. So this is designing of proof systems can be a very challenging and complicated task, in fact. And simplicity plays an important role there. Now, the other form of simplicity that I'm going to talk about is when you have a proof system. So we have designed it, and you say, okay, we work with this now, this is our game, in some sense. Then you can say that given this proof system, you can consider the proofs in this proof system, so the things that Euclid, in all his books, in the Elements, all the things he proved about his geometry, then you can say, well, you can define certain notions of simplicity, saying this proof is more simple than that proof. And there are various ways, again, that you can do this. Oh, and this is what I said at the last time. I said it already several times. There are always many choices to make, and this is also what often happens in formalizations, that you have various choices, and it's very good, of course, and I hope I can tell you so, that to realize what you, again, what you gain and what you lose by formalizing the notion. Now, the thing is, I considered not being concrete during this talk about a particular proof system and about particular formulas. But then I realized that somehow I find it difficult to convey what I want to say. So I have 2 slides, this and the next one, that are technical in the sense that are occur formulas on it. Now I will take some time to explain the details of this, and if you are really a person who hates formulas, I mean there are people like that, please consider them as decoration, because I think still some of the things I say will make sense then, even in this case. Okay. So as I said, we're going to formalize some parts of reasoning. And now what I've chosen is what you may call a toy example. But the things I'm going to say about this toy example equally well or even better apply to the real mathematical theories. Yeah? So I didn't choose it because otherwise the things I'm going to say are not true. I choose it because it fits on one slide. Yeah, and I want to be concrete about certain things. So what I'm going to do, I'm not going to consider all the statements in the world that I can make about geometry, for example, no. I'm going to restrict myself and look at very simple sentences. So my formulas, yeah, they have very simple forms. They are built of the basic things are the propositional variables, and they're denoted by PQ, doesn't matter for this talk. And the thing is, you have to think about it is this P and this Q, these stand for statements that can be either true or false. Yeah? There are various deep things to say about it, but I will only tell you the things that I need for the rest of the talk about this formalization. Yeah? So this is something P could stand for, it's raining today, Q for this is a very nice conference, or Monday is the first day of the week, things like that. And then I'm going to use 2 connectives. Juliet already in the previous talk mentioned the not, which is denoted now here by this sign, and the implication. And this not means the following, that if you have a formula, for example, your statement P is the statement Monday is the first day of the week. Then if I put a not for this P, then it's the statement Monday is not the first day of the week. Simple. The implication is, as you know, I think probably know, this symbol stands for if I have a P here at the beginning and it implies a Q, it says if P holds, then Q holds. So this is my very, very simple language. And now the thing is that, oh, maybe let me first say this. So if we restrict ourselves to this very simple language, we can still ask the same questions that Euclid asked himself. What are the true theorem? What are the theorems of this system, so to say? Which things are really true? And you probably agree with me that, for example, P implies P, very simple, beautiful formula, is definitely true. If P holds, then P holds, is an example. But if you want, so to say, to capture all the theorems about this language, then you can ask yourself, how should I do that? What are my axioms? What are my rules of the game? Now, here's an example, and I'm not saying that is beautiful. More beautiful systems will follow later. But this is a system, so to say, this was in the 19th and 20th century, beginning of the 20th century, the first way that people approached these kind of systems were in the following way. So what we have here, it's called the Hilbert-style proof system. And what you have is the following, forget this line, I return to that in a moment. Here, what I wrote down are three formulas. So the A and the B now stands for arbitrary formulas in this language that I gave you, yeah, this simple language. And these are meant to be the axioms. Yeah? So they have to be true. Now let's look at the first one. A implies B implies A, which says if Monday is the first day of the week, this implies if it's raining today, then Monday is the first day of the week, which is certainly true. It's a bit of a strange way of saying it, but it is true. Yeah? And here is the famous, well, it's not a modern Stollens, but almost, you say if not A implies not B, well, if I have B, then it must be A, because if I would have not A, I would have something like that. So you have your three axioms and you have a rule that brings you to other theorems. Because the rule says, it's the famous modus ponens rule, goes back to Aristotle, and it says if I have something A, and I have already confirmed that that is true, and I've also confirmed that A implies B, then well, I may say A, yeah? Monday is the first day of the week. If Monday is the first day of the week, then Tuesday is the second day of the week. Well, Tuesday is the second day. Simple, yeah? Now, this is notation for the logicians or the mathematicians in the audience. So this is a system for propositional, classical propositional logic with three axioms and a rule. Now, you might say, well, depends on your taste, whether you find this beautiful or not. I have to say, when I started to study mathematics, I found this beautiful, and now I find this ugly. I don't like this system, and I will tell you in a moment why. But let's first look at another system. You can say, okay, in this way I can capture all the theorems of my logic. Now, I didn't prove this, but please believe me, that is the case. Yeah? Of course, you have to do something to see that that is so. But, oh, I'm sorry. But, oh, it's okay, everything is there. But now, there's another system, it's called Frege's system, which captures the same theorems as this first Hilbert-style system, but it has, as you see, different axioms, and it has, oh yeah, something fell off, it has the same, here, sorry, it has the same rule modus ponens, and it has different axioms. Some axioms are the same as in this system, and some are different. Yeah, well, if you look at this system, is it better than the previous system? I don't know. Is it more simple? Is it more elegant? I would say people who like negations probably find this a very beautiful action. I don't, again, for various reasons. But it's very difficult to say, okay, what is better than the other? Now, at a certain point in the 20th century, people started to think about this more conceptually in some sense. And it was not so much driven towards the actions of a system, which was before the case. So here I have this one rule modus ponens, we have these actions. People started to think differently about formalization because they started to think, well, in some sense, my proof system, it should teach me something. So if I give you these axioms, as I said, I can explain, I didn't explain them all one by one, but I can explain them all one by one, why they are true. But it's not really the case that they teach you really what implication means or what negation means. They, in some sense, chose certain theorems as axioms and a rule by which you can derive the rest. But as you see, you can choose different theorems as axioms, so what's the case? And then there's an answer to that in what is called the proof theoretic semantics. At the moment that this emerged, of course, it wasn't called that way, but nowadays it's called the proof theoretic semantics. And the thing is now that if you design, I'm talking still about designing a proof system, if you design a proof system, then in the proof theoretic semantics, what you want in some sense is that the meaning of your logical symbols, so negation and implication in our toy example, is given by certain rules that allow you to say, well, if I have this, I can, no, this, sorry, forget the last sentence that I said, that was not helpful. But in some ways that you can, from this axiomatization, you really define in some sense what these connectives are. And then you have something, you really have something, because you can really honestly say, well, this is the simplest way in which I can do that. Let me show you. The thing is, we go to a different form now. So before I was talking about formulas, and the first big thing is that you talk about expressions that contain formulas but are a bit more general. Because what I'm going to talk about now is about expressions where I have a gamma, which is a set of formulas, but if you don't like it, you can think of one formula as well, and a formula A with this symbol in between it. And intuitively, this stands for A follows from assumptions gamma. So instead of considering just formulas, I still consider assumptions and formulas that follow from it. And I'm going to say what is true about this a bit more complicated relation. So the relation is a bit more complicated, but the system is much more beautiful. Because then you can say things like that. This means you don't assume here, and then, sorry, this means an axiom that you say, if I assume that gamma in A holds, well, then I can conclude A, of course. But look how beautiful it is. Here you can say, if when I assume that gamma in A holds, B holds, then I can say, well, then from gamma, A implies B. This is the rule, and now you see what you do here. You teach, this system tells you, this is the definition in some sense of implication. And here, the other rule is in some sense how you can remove an implication. You say, if A follows from gamma, and if A implies B follows from gamma, well, then, of course, B follows from gamma. So I proved, think about a mathematical proof or a philosophical rigorous philosophical argument, then what you have here is that you say, if I have already confirmed these two things, then I can confirm that. So I can remove my implications in some sense, and I can introduce them. This is the reason that this is called an introduction and this an elimination. Now, if you see this for the first time, this might look, I'm not sure whether it looks really complicated, but it, of course, looks really new. And maybe, but I hope that even if you're maybe not that familiar with these kind of symbols, that in some sense you agree that this is a very elegant and simple and beautiful system. So I think in some sense that in proof theoretic semantics, there is at least a part of an answer to which axiomatization or which formalization is simpler than another. So this part was about the designing of a proof system and how simplicity can play a role there. Now, the second part is about the given a system, what are simple proofs? And of course, again, there's not one unique answer, but there are some, I think, interesting routes to take. We have let me see. Yes, yeah, I was thinking whether I wanted to start with this lab. Yeah. So I gave you two proof systems, this Hilbert style with the formulas and this natural deduction system on the previous slide, which at least in my opinion is much more beautiful. Now, there is in both systems, there are notions of simplicity, and I will tell you about them and also about the connection between them. Now, the thing is, in the system that I gave you, the last system, there is a notion of simplicity that is in some sense involved, but I think a very good notion. And it says the following intuitively, that everything that occurs in a proof occurs in the conclusion. This means the following, and this is also, this has been a huge debate in mathematics for already, well, many centuries, is that what's often the case in mathematics is that you prove something, for example, about the natural numbers, but in your proof, you use much more complicated structures. For example, spheres, or, I don't know, algebraic fields, etc. And now, of course, I'm not going to say that these proofs are not simple, because they can be very beautiful and conceptually very simple. But what I'm saying is that at least in these formalization of proofs, there is a notion which, so to say, is related to simplicity, maybe, and that is this notion that if you have a proof and you look at the conclusion, you know that everything in the proof is, so to say, related to the objects that occur in that conclusion. No big detours, in some sense. And when you look at this notion, well, the first thing maybe to note is that it's so nice that you can formalize this, in fact, because this isn't in, you start with an intuitive thing, and it might be very difficult to define, in fact, but it's not. So what you can say formally about these systems is that a proof is called normal. That is when an introduction of a formula is not succeeded by its elimination. This is the more technical part. If you're not a logician or a mathematician or a philosopher, maybe stick to this more intuitive part, but it is the same. Yeah, this is the formal notion related to that. And now the thing is that you can show something. You can prove that in this system that I gave you on the previous slide, there is a natural deduction system for classical logic in which every provable formula has a normal form proof, has a proof in normal form. Meaning, if you give me a proof, and this applies to real systems, not only to this toy system, if you give me a proof in which I use very complicated objects, but it is about something simple, then I can give you a proof in which all objects are simple. Now, there are other problems with this proof, which will be on the next slide, but this is the statement, and this is something you can prove. And this is, interestingly, very difficult to prove. I mean, it's interesting that it's true, I think, and it's also interesting that it is difficult to prove. It took people many, many years, and still people are publishing proofs of the theorem, new proofs, because it's so complicated. And we are still, so to say, try to understand it better. But this was one part. Okay. Now, I return to this in a moment, about the problem with that proof. But first, let's go to this previous system, which was all about formulas, the more, well, the systems people started out with in logic. And then you can say, well, there is a very simple notion of complexity that's just how big the proof is. So it's really, you start with a formula, so you have a proof, you start with axioms, you have your rules so that you conclude other theorems, and you end with your conclusion. Now you can see this, in fact, well, as a sequence of formulas in some sense, and then what you say is that the size of the proof is just the number of symbols that are occurring in it. It's a notion of simplicity. It is, again, maybe a simplified notion, but it is a relevant notion, I would say, yeah? Just the size of the proof, how large is it? Okay, this is the other notion. Oh, and this is what I said, given a particular system, the size of the smallest proof of a theorem could be used as a measure of its simplicity. But then you already see that here, what is important is again that you have your choice, your design of your proof system. Because if you have a theorem, I could always make a proof system saying, well, this theorem I take as an axiom. Well, then it has a very short proof, namely the size of the formula, which we denote like this, meaning these are all the symbols, just counting from left to right that occur in A. Yeah, really, what size is. So you have, so to say, to talk about a particular, but talking about a particular system, not just choosing any, but a particular system, you can, of course, really say, well, how large is or how small is the size of this theorem? Yes, I'll continue. And the thing is that these two forms of simplicity that I gave you, this normal form thing about simple objects in the proof and this size thing, they cannot be both the case. And you can prove that again. So that is really a theorem. And again, it's not simple at all, but you can show that, as I said before, you have your beautiful, maybe, proof in geometry, but you use much more complex objects than are in your conclusion. Then the thing is, you can, so to say, rewrite this proof, and it becomes normal. But then the thing is, it has become very large. So that's what I mean when I said these two notions of simplicity, so to say, contradict each other. They cannot both be the case. I'm almost done. And here's the statement. Normal proofs are necessarily large. There are formulas with small proofs, but no small normal proofs. Yeah? So two notions, and they contradict each other. This I'm going to skip. I wanted to end here, namely, the thing is, I think the size of a proof, that the size of a proof is small, I think maybe that, to me, is not a really very good measure for simplicity. But this normality, I find a very, this smallness is a very interesting notion, for example, for implementation in computer programs and things, so it's very important. But philosophically, for me at least, I think, it doesn't really, capture my feeling of simplicity. With this normality, it's a bit different. And I think the case, in fact, is not so much my own opinion yet, but more a view on how people think, is that in syntax or proof theory, when you're more oriented towards that in mathematics, then I think normality very well captures simplicity. And I think that, for example, Hilbert was someone who very much sold off normality as simplicity. Whereas, if you're more semantically oriented in model theory, then I think this is not a notion you think captures simplicity, because there, especially in semantics, you often have proofs and you use very complicated constructions for probably simple, not simple theorems, but simple objects. So I think it's not the case. So for example, I think that someone like Poincaré was definitely not thinking of normality when he thought of simplicity. I think so. Okay, thank you very much.